You are perfect a-hole. Pledging your support for a bunch of worthless N-word will ruin your company. White America is sick and tired of this N-word BS. I canceled my order, and I know for a fact I won't be the only one. Bleep you in the bleep, you bleep of bleep. Well, obviously, we know that there's still a whole lot of division going on in America, and there's a lot of healing that still needs to happen, and we're going to continue the conversation right now with Willie Moore Jr. and Brian Barcelona. Honestly, I left our last discussion feeling hopeful. Hearing Pastor Jesse in particular share with us that racism is a sin, that gave me hope, because just recognizing that, that's a big step for us helping to find a solution. So today we're going to continue our conversation. Welcome to Brian and Willie. Thank you so much, gentlemen, for joining us today.
Yeah, my pleasure. Thank you for having us.
What do you think the church's role is in this? And what is your message to the church right now, Willie?
I feel like the churches, for years and years, we always like to have a happy ending, right? So I feel like this is an amazing indictment on our Christianity to say, where is your heart? You know, I remember growing up as a 16-year-old kid. Of course, I was adopted, never meeting anybody in my biological family. So I was a little spoiled, right? My mom and dad spoiled me, and they bought me a very, very cool car. And I remember being 16 years old, and I had on tights because I was a track runner. And I was pulled out of my car because it was cool, and I was treated like a drug dealer when literally I was on my way to be a state champion. And I just could, in any African-American person, especially if you're African-American male, you have these stories. And you can beat on the doors of the church to tell them, hey, we need help. We need you to rally the troops. But nothing ever happened. And so whether it happened now or whether it happened later, I'm just glad that it's happening. I'm glad that the dialogue is happening right now. If we look at the life of Jesus, we notice that he had 12 men, right? 12 men, 12 different perspectives, blue-collar workers and fishermen and white-collar guys who were, you know, he was a doctor, right? And so he understood all people because he was open to diversity. And I think now we're getting back to the heart of Jesus, being able to see people for people.
Awesome. Brian, what about you?
When I look at the first evangelist in the Bible, this might be controversial in itself, but it was a woman, and it was a woman at the well. And Jesus went, he pretty much said, man, this is like the issues. And he wasn't afraid of what was going on in the woman's heart. I feel like we don't like talking about race because we're so afraid of actually getting down to the pain in people. But that pain became the greatest thing that empowered her, and she went out and told everyone. And I think if we handled it so well, and if we meet people, if we even in our team, I sat down with the people, the African Americans in our community for One Voice, and I just said, tell me what you go through. I mean I'm Hispanic. I don't know if I've experienced as much pushback as you have, but man, I'd love to know, what have you gone through? What goes on in your mind?
I think that's like the biggest thing, to be able to have a real conversation. You know, a lot of times we don't even converse with people. Like, you don't even realize until this thing hit how small your circle really is and how not diverse your circle was. And so I think that is so important to communicate, to be able to communicate and understand the hearts of what people have gone through. And like, I would like to say thank you to a lot of the television mediums that I've been able to be on. Like, they're not rushing me through my conversation. They're saying, like, what really happens? Because a lot of times people get blamed just because they were uninformed, right? Like, they were just totally uninformed. I tell people, like, for us to say all white people are bad or all black people are bad, you're totally wrong, because we literally just probably have just not been informed of what people had to go through. I think everybody has a lens.
When I went out to this to LA the first time, I brought this young man with me. And when I asked him, when we got done, I said, man, how did you feel? And literally, I mean, this guy, he's just like, well, I just don't understand what's going on. And because I don't understand, I just can't have compassion. And I looked at him and I said, well, that's your problem, man. Your compassion doesn't come from understanding something. Again, your compassion comes from seeing. In Matthew 9, the Bible says Jesus, seeing that people were, you know, lost like sheep without a shepherd, he has compassion on them. I this was so new to me, systematic racism. I've never even comprehended that. And from our constitution, you know, the problem didn't start with George Floyd. The problem didn't start with this, with all of these things that have taken place in the last decades. Problem started, you know, from, I heard this one guy say, from the moment the Declaration of Independence was written, our constitution, all these things was written. He said the pen that was handed to these men was probably handed by a black slave. And I think when you look at the foundation of it, man, it's going down. We're dealing with fruit, but there's a far greater root issue in our country.
Yeah. Oh, that's great. I just have something to say on that too. My husband and our neighbor, they talk every now and then outside. He's Italian. Big guy, he works out and all that. He's got huge muscles. And I walked outside the other day because I kept hearing him talking, and they were talking about what was going on. My neighbor had asked my husband, what do you feel about what's happening? You know, how do you feel as a Black man? And my husband said, I don't even feel like I can go for a run in the neighborhood. And he was shocked to hear my husband say that. But those are the kinds of conversations I feel like that we should be having with one another to learn about each other's experiences. Willie?
I think it's Proverbs 4:6-7. It says, in the beginning, like, get wisdom. And if it costs you all you have, get understanding, right? Yeah. And all I getting, get understanding. And I think that's the biggest thing. Like, we have to understand that for years and years and years and years and years, systemically, it's been very, very tough. I got a dear friend. He's a police officer. He retired after 30 years of service in the force. He's in Chicago. Martin Luther King, he said he had stood in picket lines in Mississippi, but he had never been to a place more prejudiced than Chicago. And he said when he was being trained as a police officer, literally after you get out of, you know, your training or whatever, they send you into the African-American community to train, right? Like literally just to train, to be around drugs, to be around guns, to be around quote unquote the bad people. And you're trained that way, right? And so you're now policing people, believing at the heart of hearts that these people are vicious, that these people are tough, that these people will hurt you. And then you go in with that lens and you're supposed to be there to protect and serve. Right. And so that whole narrative is what some police officers are faced with when they come into African-American communities. And I think if the church puts a new narrative, especially in the African-American community, when you're talking to millennials, they're saying, listen, I don't want to go to church. They just want to take an offering. I'm like, nobody wants an offering. We want to give you something. Right. And shout out to my brother, Andy Stanley. He took an offering and gave it all to everybody else. Like, here, be faithful with God's money. And so shifting the narrative of what church is to people who don't know, like even us, like I did not know all the scriptures when I went to church. Mm-hmm. I had Black and Mild in my pocket and Budweiser's in my refrigerator. When I went and the Lord like took over my heart, I still had issues. But I just think if people realize that church is not a retirement plan, that perfect people don't go to heaven, forgiving people do, right? And if we just show God's mercy, I just think you'll start seeing people saying, you know what? That's the way that I want to go. So I think we have to be the example during this time, but we got to re-navigate the narrative of what people believe the church is by our actions and not by what we, well, thus said the Lord, well, what are you doing? We want to just see, is there any love for us at all in the neighborhood, please? Yeah,
absolutely, because you can scream, shout, holler, do whatever you want to do at church and then not help your neighbor the next day. So, absolutely. Brian, can you tell us about a story that you had when you encountered at a school in Compton, when you guys encountered a young lady and what she had thought about white people? And then, Willie, I want to go to you for a question right after that.
So I came to Los Angeles in 2011. And I started preaching in a lot of schools in LA, primarily East LA, South Central. Well, I felt to go to Compton some years back. I didn't know anybody. I got connected to a African-American sheriff who was also a pastor. Now, I have never sat in real life under Dr. King, but I could imagine sitting under this man and hear him speak. That was probably the closest I would ever get. This man had the most authority I'd ever heard. I feel like I was sitting under like T.D. Jakes. Like, it was powerful. It was so different. I come more from a charismatic stream. I'll listen to Bethel, and this was just so different, but I was glued in. And at the end, he set up a meeting with me. And here's what was amazing. This guy has two salaries, and he chose to move and leave the suburbs. He moved into Compton, where he was policing, so he could be in his community. And then his church had went and redid every gymnasium of the high schools in the city of Compton. So when I'm telling him, hey, I want to get into a school, he goes, what school do you want? He goes, I'll call the principal now and you'll be in. gets us into Centennial. Centennial is a school off of Piru Street. If you don't know what Piru is, it's where the Bloods originated. Mm-hmm. So I literally am preaching off of Piru Street every week. I have our club grows to about 100 kids a week in a classroom. I'm begging the principal to give us the gym. He finally gives us the gym. And we end up gathering about 300 kids a week there. But before that happened, this one girl approaches a teacher advisor who's helping us. And she's, because primarily the people we're bringing in were white, a lot of our missionaries. And she says, hey, why are all these white people coming to our school? And the teacher goes, well, they love you. Like, they're a part of Jesus Club. And she goes, we thought all white people hated us. And she goes, no, not these people. And what you began to see is reconciliation take place long before any sermon was preached. Just the presence of people coming into these communities, we'd give away free food. It was awesome. We'd give away donuts, whatever we had to give. And I think that it was so key. Again, people from other communities who will never understand what it's like to come from Compton, going into these communities and serving those communities. I mean, that's why I think we had the effect that we did, was we showed up every week. Also, there was another girl, while I was preaching one week in a classroom, she raises her hand and she says, she goes, hey, yo, mister. She goes, are you coming back next week? And I said, yeah, I'm going to be back next week. Why? She goes, maybe if you show up next week, I'll start listening to you. Mm-hmm. And it was literally like, I've realized in these communities, you can have the most incredible sermon, but the greatest power you'll carry is consistency.
Yeah.
And so I think as all this racial stuff is happening, I love what Willie said, this isn't like a 2-week deal. Like, no, how do we make this a lifestyle of reconciliation? Yes. Because it's taken a lifestyle of racism to get us where we're at. It's going to take a lifestyle of reconciliation to get us to a place of health.
Yes, absolutely. That's great, Brian. Thank you. Willie, and hearing that young girl say, we thought all white people hated us. And then we see these videos out there, you know, and what happened to George Floyd and what happened to Freddie Gray and so many other black and brown men and women. How do we begin to break down those strongholds of all white people hate us, they're going to do bad things to us, so that we can begin reconciling with one another?
You know, the truth doesn't need any help. It just needs time, right? And so if you bring into your truth, you know, as Brian so eloquently said, and you be consistent with your truth, it just takes time. This is not a quick fix. And I'm so appreciative of Brian, like, going in and speaking to young African-American women, men and women, because the truth is, sometimes you just feel so isolated. Like, they call it the trap. Like, sometimes you feel like people are just coming into the neighborhood or coming to help us because they want to make themselves feel good.
Right.
To be just another check off, you know, just another check. I did, you know what I did last week? I went in and I did this, but it takes people with the heart of beef to say, nah, I was there this week, I'll be here next week, and I'll be here next week, and I'll be here the next week, and I'll be here to, like, literally Jesus walked with people, right? You know, the narrative on these different shows are painting pictures of African-American males. And so, you know, I used to be afraid of pit bulls until I got one. You know, I was afraid, like, because they told me they would bite, they would hurt people. And I'm not comparing myself to a pit bull, but the narrative was that they are going to hurt you if they get angry. And that's the same thing that's been painted in mainstream media of African-American males. So I just want to make sure that we're shifting the narrative, changing our hearts, and understand that it's going to take time.
Right now, how important is, you know, the biblical principle of love and unity and reconciliation in the process of moving us forward? You want to start with that, Willie, and then we'll go to Brian?
I'm a little emotional. Let Brian get it.
We got to Brian.
You know, I think people got to realize that a gospel without love is a gospel without God. Mm-hmm. God doesn't just love, He is love. I think people forget that.
Amen. Amen. That was great, Brian. Willie, in us, you know, wrapping up here in just a minute, how do you think this goes to what you said, that the general public who has a perception of black women, black men, black boys in a certain way, that they can start to see black people as human beings just like them?
You know, I think that viewpoint is literally a form of brokenness, right? Like, something is broke on the inside. And for me, like, brokenness left unchecked, I just believe it's going to lead to bitterness. And bitterness will rob you of your future. And so I believe that people have become so broken that they're bitter, and you literally can't see the future that God wants to have you to have with so many people. So I think at this point, we got to have some amazing dialogue. Of course, dialogue is always needed, but then it's a heart check. You know, I'm reminded of Jesus, you know, sitting down with his disciple as he was about to go take that cross like a boss. I always say that, right? And he said, you know, I want to give you guys a new commandment. And I'm sure everybody's like, man, you always commanded something godly, you know? And then he said, I command you, you know, to love one another. And I'm sure everybody's like, all right, cool. Well, we can do that. We've been doing that. Like, that's nothing. And then he added this one part, and which speaks to his example again. He added this part and he said, love them the way I love. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure that's when it got a little tough, right? And so it just goes back to what I've been saying this entire conversation. I want every Christian who knows everything about the Bible, and I want you to go back and read those gospels looking for his example, not for something to preach, not for something to make you feel like you have so much knowledge. The Bible tells us that knowledge puffs up, but love builds up, right? But if we can just go back and read those scriptures and look at Jesus's beautiful example of how he loved the widow, how he loved people who had leprosy, how he loved people who were blind, how he even loved the people who were crucifying him by saying, forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do. I wish he would have been more specific in who he was talking to, but I just believe by faith that I'm a part of the day. Like, yeah. I believe that he loved, and you're a part of the day, and everybody's a part of the day. So if we could just take that example that Jesus has set, it can open up your heart, fix that brokenness that's now turned into bitterness, and you can see this beautiful future that we have, because I just believe we're better together. And you know, to my Black people who watch this, because I know my audience is primarily African-American, and a lot of people say when I get on TBN that I kind of sugarcoat my message. I just want to tell you, as an African-American man or female, just understand we can't do this by ourselves. We have to work with lesser melanated people in order for us to work together. And if somebody is looking to be an ally towards the bigger mission, we have to open up our hearts again, because there's no way an African-American person can be a racist, but we can be prejudiced to some of the help that is coming for us. And so I've been opening up people's hearts, minds, and spirits to know that there are different people who are going to partner with us, and we can't be so pro-Black that we can't allow other people to help us, right? Because we need help in this fight, and we're all in this thing together.
Yep, it's not going to take just one group. It is going to take all of us, Willie. Brian, what about you? What would you say to that, you know, someone who is a minority but not Black, how people can begin to see African-Americans as human beings? Black men aren't out to get you. You know, they're not out to harm you. That you don't have to be afraid when you're around a Black man.
Yeah, I don't know if you guys are familiar with Bill Johnson. I did a Zoom with Bill 2 days ago. And I asked him how he remained unoffended for so many years. You know, Bethel Church has had so many controversies. And if you ever meet Bill, he's just this joyful man. And he said, I never remember once my parents discussing anything negative of anybody in our home. Now, he says, I have no memory of it. Not once. Not at the dinner. They never vented about church problems. They never vented about ministry. He talked about this guy who split up the church. And his father kept blessing him. And that guy's wife passed away. And the guy reached out to Bill's dad. And Bill did the funeral. I think it starts in our homes. It doesn't start in our churches. It starts at the conversation. I have 3 kids. It starts at the conversations I'm having with my children. You know, unknowingly, I think every culture carries some sort of prejudice or racism against other cultures. You know, and I think it starts off by in our home. I sat my daughter and there's a girl who's lived with our family who's African American for 5 years, and I had explained the other day to my daughter racism, and I says, you know, my daughter's 4, and I says, honey, let me explain this to you. Imagine someone beating, you know, Lauren because of the color of her skin. Would that be okay? She goes, no, daddy, that's not. And I said, exactly, honey, we're teaching them from a young age. Not to be colorblind, because I think that's not good either. We value cultures. We value color. I don't want to teach my daughter that, like, you know what I mean? Like, no, like, we are different colors, but man, we're the same race. We're human race. Like, God created us equal. And so I think the conversations of that has to begin first at the homes. And the greatest pulpits for that is our kitchen tables. It's our living rooms.
Thank you. Willie, how important is forgiveness? And what are some scriptures that come to your mind that would help us keep the process of moving forward?
You know, forgiveness is just something that I had to wrestle with. You know, a lot of times you don't understand that what's going on in your heart. You know, I think the biggest scripture that sticks out to me, because I'm an action person, I like to see people act. The Bible says, let the redeemed say so, right? You should be able to say something. Case in point, you know, being adopted, never meeting my biological parents, you know, I just covered over it with this amazing gospel and just said, you know, I love everybody. But deep down inside, after consecration, I understand that I still had an issue with my mother for not stepping up to the plate. And it wasn't until years and years that I was able to speak something out of my mouth positive about her to say that I hope she's blessed. I pray that her finances are good. I pray that her health is well, you know. And so I believe that if you are redeemed, you should be able to speak out your mouth and move that mountain of hate, be able to speak out of your mouth something that's going to be positive and move people in the right direction. Because I just believe a lot of times we spew out so much hate because there's so much unforgiveness on the inside of us. So usually when I'm asking people, did you forgive somebody? Did you forgive your mom? Did you forgive your dad? Did you forgive that injustice? They say, yeah, I forgave. I'm like, okay, cool. Well, say something great about it. And that's when they usually get stumped. Well, I mean, I thought I did. And they get real cool and they get real jazzy. I'm like, okay, then the Bible says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. So if the Lord has redeemed you from that issue, I want you to speak out of your mouth something great about your mom, something great about that community that you said you've forgiven. And until then, I still think we need a heart check.
Brian, what would you say? What are some scriptures that are speaking to you right now to help us move forward in this situation so that we're not having this same conversation a year from now? Oh, look what happened to this next Black gentleman.
Yeah, I think the world will know we're his disciples by the way we love. And I think love, you know, I realized this with the situation that happened in my with my family. You know, I've preached for 11 years in schools, and it wasn't until it was my own sister that was navigating through some things that was very, very opposite of my faith that I learned that love meets people in their need. And so I'd say, man, if our standard of being a disciple isn't just showing up to church and reading a Bible, but it's actually loving one another, it changes the game. Because discipleship, a lot of times we see it as this to-do list. Well, I've prayed in the morning 30 minutes. I've had a latte with God, whatever that means. you know, I've gone to church. I've paid my tithe. I mean, that stuff's easy. You know what I mean? I can throw 10%, like whatever. If I can throw 12%, like that doesn't require anything of us as loving people. Loving people costs. I mean, Willie said that scripture, you know, Jesus says, Father, forgive them for they don't know what they do. Why is that statement so powerful? Because Jesus fully understood his pain and fully made a choice. Someone who's numb or haven't come to grip with what they've gone through, you can forgive easily because you don't know the cost of what it took to the pain it's caused. When you fully embrace the pain you've gone through, I love this. When you forgive someone, you're choosing to remember that moment, not forget the moment. You're choosing to remember it from a place of no pain. And I think that's the difference. Forgiveness isn't saying I'm going to it's never happened. Like, yeah, like it happened, but I'm not remembering anymore from a place of pain. I'm remembering from a place of forgiving. And I love this. I did a live the other day with Christine Kane and this blew my mind. She said, that scripture, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us as we forgive those. She said, next time you don't want to forgive someone, tell God to forgive you as you forgive other people. Mm-hmm. That'll change the way you forgive. And I think, man, like that, if we position our hearts to say discipleship standard is raised, forgiveness standard is raised, I want Jesus's model, it's going to cause us to love.
You know what, guys, just as we close, I just want to say this. Thank you so much, Juice TV, for always allowing me to come in. B, we got to get together, man. I love your spirit. I love your heart. Sesame, you are amazing. Shout out to Mark. You know, I just end this way. You know, I had the esteemed privilege to sit my 17-year-old African-American son down. I got a chance to sit my 11-year-old African-American son down. And I have a 5-year-old African-American son as well. And, you know, it's really tough to to be raising African-American males in this world. I got an opportunity to sit them both down and just talk a little bit about the George Floyd scenario and many other scenarios, for they've seen dad travel the country to empower people during pandemics and racial injustice. And they seen me do a lot of that stuff. And I kind of shield them away from it because we live a very different life than what I grew up in. And I was talking to them a little bit about how to conduct themselves when working with police officers and law enforcement, right? And I told them, listen, on the side of the road is not the place where you get tried. You're going to be the judge and the jury. We're not doing that. You have the right to remain silent, right? You literally have the right to remain silent, and you bring that back to your dad, right? And then I'll work on that. But I want you to be calm. I want you to be peaceful. I let them know that law enforcement, they don't understand hand gestures like that. They may be aggressive, so keep your hands here. And I had to do that to a 17-year-old and 11-year-old, but I did not tell my 5-year-old. And I'm going to tell you why I didn't tell my 5-year-old, because I believe that if we work together as one conducive unit, moving in one direction, serving one Jesus Christ, I believe that we won't have the same issues when he's 15. And yeah. So I'm challenging you guys, right? And so. I'm challenging everybody who's under the sound of my voice to know that your African-American brothers and sisters, we are hurting. And we can try to put a smile on our face, but every single day that we go outside, especially if you become successful, you don't know what's going to happen on the side of the road. And so just be praying for us. And even if you don't understand, don't make an insensitive comment. Sit down and try to find out what you can do, because I'm telling you, as a Christian man, your brothers are hurting. So we're challenging you to come alongside us. So my 5-year-old, I won't have to have this conversation when he's 15.
Willie, I'm believing you with that, because I don't want the same for my 3-year-old son. You know, when he gets older, I want that this is not going to be an issue anymore. And I just wanted to say how you said that every Black man has a story like this. I finally, for the first time, Brian asked my dad, hey, do you have, you know, a story about police when you were young? And he said, yeah, they lived up in Philly. And he said the cops would always run up on them in their house and they would arrest them for, you know, no reason. And they would take them to the white neighborhoods and they would push them out of the car. And then they would pull out their guns and they would say, run, and word, run, and shoot and point in their guns at them. So this is, you know, real. And that made me sad to hear, you know, that happened to my dad. You know, he's a successful man and the Lord has blessed him in life. And so I wouldn't even think that something like that happened, but he said it happened a lot. Brian, can you take us out with a quick prayer?
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Yeah, Father, I thank you so much for Juice TV, God. I thank you for Willie's voice, God. I just thank you so much for the honor it is to be here on this call. God, I thank you that in this season you are highlighting racial reconciliation, but I truly believe it's because a great revival is coming to our country. And I thank you that repentance always precedes revival. And I thank you, Jesus, that underneath the riots rumbles revival, that underneath, God, the pain, God, is going to be a prophetic message that will be declared all across this country. And I just pray, Jesus, right now that this interview here, God, would touch so many lives. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Brian Barcelona and Willie Moore Jr., our favorite here at Juice TV, thank you. Thank you. Thank you, gentlemen, so much for joining us and pouring your wisdom into us and our viewers. We appreciate it, guys.
Thank you, guys. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you guys so much for watching, and everybody have a great day.